and I will talk about a little bit about the future, how I see the OPC way will development and the implementation will continue. Yes, the current state, how I see that now we are using those OPC way servers. We are connecting data to cloud, as we have seen today, and I think we will have still one presentation about how we can run the digital twins on cloud. Then we are integrating multi-vendor systems. That is nowadays quite a lot of different clients have been connected to different kind of servers, and same with the OPC way clients. We are connecting different vendor clients to servers and servers to clients, and the balance seems to be that 1/3 of the deployments are servers and 2/3 of the deployments installed OPC way products are clients. And at the moment, what I see the data models, we are just transferring mainly the basic types they are used. So we are just using the floats, doubles, boolean, integers. Those variable types are used. So it's not very advanced data model used yet, but it's what people are and the customers are doing at the moment. And if we look what is then happening, in some cases we have those data items, we have definition, engineering rates, minimum, maximum, engineering units implemented with the OPC Way Foundation according to specification. And then we will have the devices, so there are auto ID, process automation, device information model, those are now coming. So we are starting to use those. Then as the previous presentation was that we are using the OPC Way to ERP or mesh integrations. So that is also good direction now. Then the historical access, what I have seen the use cases mainly that we can synchronize missing data that has been not pushed to cloud. We can actually read that afterwards between the mill historian and the cloud analytics. So we can actually fill up the missing time ranges if there has been some data connectivity problem or some part of the process has been down and the data transfer haven't been working. And then the alarms and conditions, those events, those can be used to find some problems from the time series data. But I haven't seen yet so very wide use of those alarms and conditions. So those are now, let's say, maturing the those data models and different kind of new integrations. So they are coming step by step also, just from the traditional data transfer. So what we are actually needing is companion specifications, and we will need the rich metadata. Those device models are used for the condition monitoring, and that was also a good presentation that the asset management will contain new information models for this. But also digital twins, those will need the metadata, and also most probably own data models will be someday built for the digital twins. But that's, let's say, the little bit more harder to use, because the digital twin can be also used for the operational efficiency or condition monitoring or some other target. So those are still a little bit too abstract that we can get a practical implementation of the digital twin, but they are maturing also. And that's the also good direction. But those are, we have a people who are making those data models, and I think those will pop up later or sooner. And if we look then to those event-based systems like 6.14.99, so at the moment we are mainly or always using the static configuration. And that's behavior is coming that we can actually make dynamic runtime behavior. So the current systems, they are made with the static. So the design is static and the data flow is fixed. But there is coming those event-based systems. This is one use case example. As the pump starts, that's an event. it will start. We can actually then enable historical data collection for those related variables. So we can start collecting data for the analytics, short period, 5 minutes, and then stop or disable the historical data access. Then we can actually run analytics and validate the accuracy if the pump is cavitating or if there's some other anomaly. And then we can store the result. This is kind of the operative digital twin that is running just on demand. And this is one interesting because it can be run on site. I have also the better view from here. So this is the, for example, the pump that is pumping here. So we have to actually collect the data from all these variables that I have put here with the red color. So the pump starts, that's an event. Then we can collect the related variable historical data access. We have that already on site. We can use either the persistent historical data access if those are pre-configured static configuration, but we can also instantiate the memory-based historical data access during the runtime. So we can initialize this kind of the anomaly detector that it will have all the variables also in the historical data access. So then we can actually get the historical data, what is needed time span. We can either train the model or run detector and then store the results. And that can be used for the condition monitoring. And the same with the level runtime predictor. So we can actually look the level and train the model and then run the prediction. And then we have the forecast, what is the tank level, let's say in 15 minutes or 1 hour. It's not forecasting very long because normally these process variables there is not so big tanks and the process is normally running with quite high speed. And those tanks are not so big. But that's the one kind of the example what I see the future. So we can actually build the different kind of small digital twins that can be run on the edge level and the event-based. So they can actually, when there is happening some event, then we can actually run the needed model for those variables that are related. And in the same way, we can actually make some forecasting models when we train on the fly those models. Of course, this needs quite a lot of the different kind of programming. I think because these are disturbances related events or some other, the most of the data flow is actually not needed. So we are actually using those for the long-term analytics or training, or the snapshots can be done with those or already collected data. But this is somehow the challenge for the server client, how we are using normally the server and client. So we need those server methods to make changes to the runtime system. And then these clients have to be more clever. It's the kind of new intelligent automation. So we are not anymore the building or making the pre-configuration. It's more needing the metaprogramming. So the actual the program can instantiate or build needed digital twin during the runtime. And that's the more a challenge for the how we should actually then think about the how we are using the OPC UA. Of course, we are then the benefits, pros and cons. We are using the less resources because we don't have to store all the time everything. But then we have the on-demand peak. If there's a lot of events at the same time, that can be overloading the CPU. So we need some orchestration that it can run distributed parallelities, or it can build a queue that can then execute the needed analytics. And that's the one interesting. I'm actually making one research program called AISA, and there we are now experimenting and building this proof of concept. it's the embedded intelligence. So we have already built the artificial intelligence server, and then we can connect the clients that are actually then making those predictions and returning the results to the server. So that's the first step, that we are building the this kind of new architecture, but it's not yet containing all these ideas what I'm presenting now. But that's actually the future that I have been thinking about, what kind of systems, if we have the event-based programming or the automation, we should have also somehow the event-based analytics that is running on demand. And that's the new way that I'm thinking about, we should actually prepare the also the OPC UA to fulfill these kind of demands. And then this is already the summary part. I have still one bonus slide, but this smart industry, we need this kind of the hybrid digital twins. So it can be these smaller use cases like pumps and measurements, but we are building hierarchies from these ones. And from these hierarchies, we can go up a level to systems. And this enterprise level intelligence will provide us possibility that we can build autonomous mills. It's a different kind of the automation. Let's say it's the intelligent automation, as I have been putting here, the next level, next generation intelligent automation, because it's the more learning what is happening in the process, and it can mimic what the operators can do if we are collecting the data clever way and using that to first train the models and then actually run the models during the execution or running the process. It's also a little bit what the Napcon has done with that intelligent automation, but this is the perhaps the one way that we could implement it with the smaller steps and even still expand it to the mill level. Then I have here the one extra bonus slide. So we have this mixed reality, the virtual reality system, Valmet XR, and we are using the OPC UA also there. So we have these user interface components with the metadata. So we have this clean chest level that is coming from the data item, the definition text, and then we get also the actual value, we get the engineering unit, we get the minimum and maximum value also from the data item. And so it's actually animating the tank level during the execution. And same with this coach, the needle is according to range, and it's also showing the correct value. And this is the no-code principle. So we can actually browse the OPC UA address space and just drag and drop these into the virtual environment and the select animation. And we have also the state text. So two-state discrete, we can have the on-off or start-stop text, and multi-state discrete is used normally for the enumerations. So we can have multiple states in the data item. So we are now taking also the auto metadata into the use also at the virtual reality. And the same metadata is available also for the analytics, that we can actually scale to see what is the maximum of the range that the device is operating and what is the minimum of the range that the pump is running, for example, auto pressure, auto flow. But this is the part of the when we are making the anomaly detection, when we are building the dynamic windows for the variables and training the virtual, the digital twin. Okay, I think that was my ideas that I was presenting, and any questions from the audience?
Thank you, Mika.